Chapter 14. The Defense Rests. September 30th, 1959. When Frank Donnelly rose to give his closing arguments to the jury, the trial had been going on for one day short of 2 weeks. The jury had been sequestered, isolated, all that time. They had eaten together, rested together, and had been prisoners themselves for that time. They had not been allowed to phone home. They were not in a good mood. And they were now to be bombarded with 2 full days of summing up, by the defense, by the Crown, and then instructions to the jury by the judge. If you've ever sat through a lecture lasting more than 1 full hour, you may have some idea of how they felt. Frank Donnelly had little more to add, but he took a full day in court to add it. He began. Now, in this particular trial, we have what is known as direct evidence and circumstantial evidence. The jury slumped in their seats. 2 weeks of sitting through 71 witnesses, and now this, a lecture from law school. Donnelly droned on. Now, there is direct evidence that this young girl was murdered. You have heard the evidence of the 3 members of the Air Force who found the body. You have heard Dr. Peniston and this girl was murdered. That is direct evidence. But there is no direct evidence which in any way links this boy with that murder, which was true. In essence, though, Crown Attorney Hayes has been right in his opening statement. The whole case came down to 1 hour period on the night of June 9th on a 1.6 kilometer section of the country road north from the air base to Highway 8. That road ran first past Lawson's Wood and then over the bridge. In the summation, both the Crown and the defense focused on the testimony of 2 witnesses, Richard Galatly and Philip Burns, both of whom had left the bridge at the same time and proceeded along the country road south to the airbase. Richard had left the south end of the bridge at about 7:20, riding his bike. Philip Burns, age 10, had left about the same time on foot. Oddly, neither remember seeing each other, but an adult witness placed both on the country road near the bridge about that time. Richard rode his bike to the school on the country road and met Lynn and Stephen near O'Brien Farm, about 250 meters from the school. Philip, walking the same route, did not see Stephen and Lynn. Philip had not mentioned seeing Jocelyn Godet and Butch George, nor any one of the several other people on the road at the time, including Steve and Lynn. Donnelly simply noted that Philip was an unsworn witness. The jury cannot use the testimony of an unsworn witness to convict or acquit someone. Crown Attorney Hayes wove the story more convincingly. But Philip Burns, Hayes insisted, testifies that he did not meet Stephen Lynn or either of them. He stopped and looked directly at the jury. I ask you, is that not pretty conclusive that Stephen Lynn turned off the country road into the bush? What other explanation is there? Where else could they have gone? Where indeed? The Crown Attorney didn't bother to mention that Philip Burns was an unsworn witness, or that the defense had 3 sworn witnesses who placed Stephen at the bridge when he said he had been at the bridge, Dougie Oates, Gord Logan, and Alan Oates. Hayes had a different view of this same information. His whole summation supported the story the Crown wanted the jury to believe, that Stephen had taken Lynn Harper into Lawson's Woods, strangled and raped her, covered her body with branches from saplings growing nearby, and returned to the schoolyard. Witnesses who said they saw Stephen Lynn cross the Bayfield Bridge he called liars. Dougie Oates was a liar. Gordon Logan was a liar. Alan Oates was a liar. Each sticking up for a friend. At what should have been the end of 13th day of trial, the defense basically said, the evidence is all circumstantial, and we have witnesses who support Stephen's story. The Crown simply called them all liars and said only Stephen could have committed this crime. Then the judge gave his instructions to the jury. Chapter 15. Here comes the judge. September 30th, 1959. After 11 days of trial, 13 days with Sundays off, the jury had spent 1 whole day listening to the defense sum up. 6 unstoppable hours. They then spent a whole day listening to Crown Attorney Glenn Hayes summing up. By then, it was 4:30 p.m. on the lucky 13th day of the trial. The jury was tired at this point. Tired of testimony, tired of the courtroom, tired of the droning voices that often repeated the same points. Instead of letting the jury go and resuming the following day, Judge Ferguson gave everyone a 15-minute break and then launched into his 3-hour charge to the jury. Some of his instructions were right from the judge's instruction manual. In his monotone, Judge Ferguson defined homicide, culpable homicide, indecent assault, and circumstantial evidence. No one saw the prisoner kill Lynn Harper. The Crown, therefore, puts its case squarely on all of the circumstances and asks you to find from the circumstances that the accused is guilty. To the testimony of children, he gave special note. In twos and threes, the children were brought in, reintroduced to the jury, and paraded out. Ronald DeMary, Dougie Oates, Paul Desjardins, Kenneth Gager, Rod Harrington, Jocelyn Godet, Arnold George, Philip Burns, Richard Galati, Ellen Oates, Gord Logan, Brian Glover, Thomas Gillette. The aim, apparently, was to refresh the memories of the jury. The effect was likely the opposite, of adding to their wariness and confusion. For almost 3 hours, Judge Ferguson reviewed the evidence. Who saw what doctors said about the time of death, about Steve's penis sores, his dirty underwear. All of it was circumstantial, with three exceptions. The three young people, sworn witnesses, who told stories that supported Steve's version of events. If they were believed, even the judge was clear on this point. Steve was not guilty. Neither the jury nor the judge knew that, hidden in the police files, there was a statement from a fourth witness who supported Steve's story, Karen Dam, then 9 years old. The little girl who was hunting for turtles with Dougie Oates had also been questioned by police. She even gave a signed statement in which she supported Dougie Oates' story and had seen Stephen and Lynn bicycle past the bridge. Years later, she recounted that police took her to the scene 3 times and badgered her to change her estimate of where she had seen them. But Karen stuck to her story, and predictably, the Crown never called her for a witness. Since laws of the time did not require full disclosure, the Crown and the police did not reveal the existence of her statement to the defense. Donnelly did not call her as a witness because he did not know of her story. Even as an unsworn witness, her appearance might have corroborated the stories of the others. Finally, the judge came to the point the jury had been waiting for. You are now free to retire, gentlemen, and consider your verdict. The sheriff will look after your dinner. Life is never quite that simple, of course. The jury had barely returned to the jury room when the judge called them back for clarification. Defense attorney Frank Donnelly had objected to a number of points made by the judge. Before 2 hours had passed, the jury had been called back a total of 3 times and returned once on their own for clarification. At 10.05 p.m., the jury filed back into the courtroom and took their seats. Floorboards creaked. The courthouse crowd sat in silence. The court register stood. Gentlemen of the jury, have you agreed upon your verdict? The foreman of the jury also rose. No, my lord, we have not. George Ferguson sat back in surprise. You have not? We want some more information. Can I read this? Yes. The foreman read from a paper in his hand. A redirection of evidence, corroborated or otherwise, of Lynn Harper and Stephen Truscott being seen together on the bridge on the night of June the 9th. The request was a key point. If Steve and Lynn were together on the bridge, Steve could not be guilty. Judge Ferguson outlined the facts. That Dougie Oates said Steve and Lynn were on the bridge headed north at about 7:30 p.m. Alan Oates and Gord Logan said the same. But then he expanded on his answer. He stated that Alan Oates would make a shaky recognition of Steve on his bike at 800 feet, and that Gord Logan stood on a rock 640 feet east and had seen them through a guardrail 40 inches high. He also reminded them that Philip Burns walked south from the bridge and had not seen either Lynn or Steve, nor had Jocelyn Godet and Arnold George. The going back and forth across the bridge is of very little importance, because the question is, did he kill her? That is the point in this case, the judge concluded. Finally, at 10:45 p.m., the jury retired one last time. 10 minutes later, at 10:55 p.m., on a day that began at 10 a.m., the jury returned. This time, they had a verdict. Chapter 16. The verdict is in. September 30th, 1959. The judge waited until the jury resettled into their seats. The wooden floors and chairs creaked. Otherwise, the room was pale with silence. Do you find the prisoner at the bar guilty or not guilty? Asked a court official. The jury foreman rose. We find the defendant guilty as charged with a plea for mercy. Judge Ferguson looked at Stephen. He said, the prisoner stand up. Steve, still the obedient kid, stood. Stephen Murray Truscott, I have no alternative but to pass the following sentence upon you. The jury have found you guilty after a fair trial. The sentence of this court upon you is that you be taken from this place. Stephen Truscott became the youngest Canadian in history to be sentenced to death by hanging. So much for mercy.